the center of gravity. And the center of gravity is when you have a, you're in a comfortable position, whether you're, it's kind of like I tell guys, and you can use a lot of parables. When a guy hits a home run and he's standing at the plate, he's got a good center of gravity and he can do that. When you shoot a jump shot and you're a basketball player, what do you have to do to elevate? You have to have a center of gravity to elevate, okay? When you're a football player, what do you have to do to block good? You have to have a center of gravity. Center of gravity comes in balance, okay? And it means balance. It means not being overextended. So those are things. Your stance to me should be relaxed. Slight bend on the inside, slight bend on the inside. Like if I'm on the left and the quarterback's over there, inside foot forward, outside foot back, I want the back foot right here, I want this back foot, I want that toe pointed in. I want that toe. Let's see. Yeah, I see if I'm an athlete. I want that back toe to be in a straight line. I don't want it to be cocked out like this. I want it in a straight line. I want that inside, I want that foot up. I want that foot in a nice straight line, maybe slightly turned in, so that you can push off the balls of your feet. The balls of your feet, which are the inside insteps, are what make the difference between the center of gravity and not. Guys, I've always said this, and this is an evaluation for you guys, for what you do. Sometimes you have to take what you get. In our situation, we pick, but sometimes, guys, a lot of times, we pick wrong. Guys that are slew-footed, you have to work real hard to coach them. I mean, where their feet turned out, you have to work your ass off to coach them where their feet, they can learn to do this, because that's how you establish the center of gravity. So that's really big. And in blocking in the base, it all is about the base techniques. Now, what I'm going to go from here to talk about is, I'm going to talk about some different types of blocking, you know, in essence. And I got this. Brilliant blocking, there's four types of blocks. For a wide receiver, we're talking about blocking. And there's, okay, number one is a stalk block. We'll come back and talk about that. Number two is a crack block. Number three would be a cross field block. Number four was be a what I call push and seal block. Push and seal. Okay, and those are the types of blocks that involve the wide receiver blocking as from a receiver standpoint. Now, the stalk block is the most basic of all the blocks. Okay, it basically involves a receiver blocking a defensive back, whether he's in an off position or whether he's in a tight position or whether he's in a rotated position. Okay, so you're basically, the scenarios you can get for, and we'll just use, and if you have a question, guys, okay, ask. The positions I'm talking about are, you can have a corner in an off position. You can have a corner in a rotated position with a zone with some kind of help on the safety. You can have a corner in a press position. That's what we're talking about. You know, the different looks that you can get, okay? Now, let's just take the first one. When a defensive back's in an off position and the receiver's responsibility is to block him, the first thing you want to do is you want to come off the ball aggressively with a very good first step and begin to push. And you want to look, I always tell them, your nose, the tip of your nose as a receiver is your radar. So if I say, Coach, if I'm the receiver and I'm coming up the field and you're playing in a slightly outside technique, and I push, my nose should go to your nose. That's my radar. That tells me where I'm going. My nose is my radar for where I'm going to go directionally. So I'm going to push right at you. I'm going to take you as far as you go. But eventually, if you're playing in a zone and you're looking at the quarterback or looking in the backfield, he's going to see that it's a run, and he's going to begin to react. As he begins to break down and move forward, the receiver needs to begin to break down. And as you break down, this is the hardest thing to teach. Many years ago, I used to coach in an option offense. God, that's all you did. You know, that was what everybody did. Everybody ran the option. Everybody throws it nowadays, but everybody ran the option. And it was hard to, you know, that's all you spent your time on. So I need a demonstrator right here. I'm the receiver, I got one right here. I'm pushing up the field, he's backing up. Okay, as he starts to come forward, now, here's the thing, you run it, guy's running with a good speed, he's got his nose into nose looking at you. As you begin to break down, I need to begin to break down. I need to break down, and as I break down, what am I trying to get to? Center of gravity. And here's the mistake that's made over and over again, is guys let their head come forward. You need to drop your ass, and you need to let him decide which way he's going to go. Then you need to punch. Then you need to hit him. Guys get up here and they let their head go. What are they going to do? They're taught to do what? Grab and throw. So when you sit, you want to sit here. He's going to give you a head fake. And the next thing that's most important is you want to slide step. If he goes that way, I want to slide this way. The mistake they make is they want to chase and cross over on the head fake, and then they're beat. So you got to push vertically. Take him as far as he'll go. If he'll run with you all the way, then don't worry about it. That's what you're coaching him to do, is take that guy as far as he'll go. As he begins to break down, you begin to break down. Emphasis point. You got to drop your hips and be patient. You don't need to, I have guys that come out of college and they on their ass in third base about blocking. Okay? And you drop that weight, and I see him beginning to come, and I drop my butt down. I'm keeping my feet moving, but I don't need to chase. Don't start getting, this is what they want to do. They want to chase. Just sit down and be patient. Let him come, boom, then you go ahead. If he starts to head fake, keep your butt down and slide step. On the stalk block, you're trying to occupy that guy, you're trying to hold him off, and you're trying to let the back cut off of you. The question.
Do you always want your receiver to stay square to the defender?
Parallel to the line of scrimmage? Yes,
absolutely.
I do.
What if you're running off tackle towards your side? Do you ever want him to get an angle to try to push more towards the sideline? Or
no. You know what happens? Here's the comment.
Like when they break down, do you want them to turn, or do you want it to be you stay square and then allow the back to read whichever way?
I want them to stay square. Because here's what happens. I've seen this a million times, okay? Here's what happens if you give them that leeway. In their minds, you start letting them turn their butt, and here's what they'll do. They'll come down inside some, and then they'll get like this. And they'll start wanting to turn their ass toward the ball.
Right.
And what they do is they give this guy the edge. It's just like pass protection. If you're teaching a guy to pass protect, young kids think if they turn their ass like this and make that guy go there, that they're helping themselves. They shorten the corner. It's the same out in space. When you turn that butt down inside, you shorten the corner. Now, if I'm here square, he decides he wants to go that way. Now I'm going to be aggressive and go at him and kick him out of there.
You take his shoulder and then go.
Yeah, you want to punch. I always try to teach him, as they go right here, punch with that arm right there. I'm talking about boom. I'm talking about punch hard. You know, you can get him over on the bag. You got a big blocking bag, and just punch, like boom. And they get to where they think they're tough, and they punch, and it's, you know, you can stone a guy. You know, you can just boom right there. But you want to stay square. When you start letting it, I've seen it so many times I can puke. They come running down the field, the guy starts to come up, they want to do this. Because they think they're helping themselves in their mind. They think they're making the guy choose a side. You know, all they do is short the corner. And that guy comes running off their butt. We get it all the time because the corners are so aggressive. So key coaching points are push, settle. And when you coach it now, guys, that settle part about not wanting to keep your feet moving, keep your head up there and doing that, that's going to be the hardest thing to coach. Because they're going to want that, they're going to get bit, what I call busy. Don't get busy now. Busy means they're all, you know, push, settle, center of gravity. He comes, let him react, and then go punch. Now, if you got a guy who's, your guy's 145, the corner's 175. As a change-up, what I'll do is I'll tell him, push, settle, he comes, chop. As a change-up. Because what happens is Now, if they chop the next time, the guy's a little, just a little more cautious, and it's advantageous to the blocker. But you, it's after you've already done this and stalk blocking a couple of times that you, then you can chop them if they come aggressively and try. If a guy thinks he can overpower a littler guy, that's what they'll try to do is intimidate and run over. So what I tell them to do is every now and then change up. But I tell them if you're going to chop him, you got to. If you're going to cut him, are you all allowed to cut?
No.
Okay. They're about getting to that. We're about getting to that point too, almost. But if you can't do that, then again, that's you better punch good.
Is there a specific aiming point for the punch? Is it just so
well,
the numbers?
He's going to try to throw you. He's going to do two things. He's going to head fake, or he's going to try to grab and throw you aside. So I tell him in the punch, try to get it into here. The other thing you want to do is, and this is another hard thing, is that as that guy's head faking, you want to be looking at his chest. And I always tell him, if the guy can make his chest move, then we need to get him off the football field, get him in the circus, and get him. We'll all make a lot of money, because the chest ain't going to move. The head's going to move. They're going to try to be quicker and all that stuff, but you want to keep your head glued into his numbers, and his numbers aren't going to move, and you won't get head fake. But that's a stalk block, a stalk block versus a... Now, there's another kind of stalk block. Let's say the corner is a guy playing some press, say he's playing a cover two, but with a corner safety. Okay. One of the mistakes guys make when that guy gets in that up position is on the snap of the ball, a lot of times they want to stand up. I always tell them, your first step needs to be hard, very hard, depending on how close he is, but you need to come off the ball. Because most defensive backs, if your first step is really hard and they're fairly close, you'll get a little bit of a reaction out of them. So I always tell them, if that guy's in a cloud coverage and he's about 2 yards from you and something like that, your first step, you got your inside foot up, is take that first step hard, get that guy to react, and then you can settle at the line of scrimmage or maybe a yard or two over it, and then let him come. Because a lot of times if you're running a sweep play, what are you trying to do for the back? You're trying to buy time. So you don't want to block him. You step, you settle, and then you're trying to stay in that guy's way so the back can cut off of you. You don't want to block the guy too soon. You might beat him and then him recover and make the play. So I'll tell him, step, settle. Here he comes. Now, his coach to turn it back inside. If he chooses that route, then you're going to turn him out and block him outside. Again, staying square. Don't do this, because here's the odds. They see that and they want to go, come off the ball, want to come up here and then turn their ass inside like this. Now this guy's right there, he cuts the running lane down, and you don't have any running lane for your back. You're trying to create, when you have rotation to the receiver in any kind of rotated zone, you're trying to create bigger seams for the running back, not smaller seams. So when you're out here in this position right here, and this guy goes down inside and does that, he shortens the corner, and that guy knifes off of him right there. Now you've taken away from the space you're trying to create for your running back. If the play's going away from him, it doesn't make a lot of difference. But if it's coming to him and he has the key outside block to block that corner, then you're trying to do two things, buy time. And I always try to tell our receivers, know the running game. What kind of play is it? Is it a play that's going to get there real fast? Is it a play going to take a while to develop? That's what you got to know. And so, like when we run reverses, we run a couple different reverses, and one of them we'll run is off of a counter. But we'll run 60 counter, Z reverse, out of this. We can run either out of one or two back. This guy jab steps, he comes here. Okay, we're blocking it down. We're pulling the guard. Doing all that stuff, and then the uncut uncovered lineman's coming out here, we're blocking down with that guy, and then this guy's handing the ball to this guy, and I tell this guy against cover two, widen this guy, because you don't have him, but widen him and create more running lane for the back so that the uncovered lineman, when he pulls out there, he's got a lot of space. Don't release inside against a rotating corner, let this guy see it coming. Now the guy pulls, and now you cut the running lane. Okay.
Then you send the receiver out after the safety?
Yeah. We have a couple, what I tell our guys is in passing or running game. In pro ball you got a lot of different coverages and you get a whole bunch of, you can get into a whole bunch of gibberish. But in the passing game, in any situation, here's what I tell guys. You don't have to know every coverage, but what you need to know is the middle of the field closed or is the middle of the field open? If the middle of the field's closed, that means they got a free safety back there. Okay? So, if the middle of the field's closed, we have a free safety in the middle of the field. No matter what the, how the look is, off, on, whatever, we have a corner, we have a weak safety, we have some kind of strong safety, and we have some kind of, this depends on what the coverage is, but is the middle of the field closed? Okay, is the middle of the field open? If the middle of the field is open, then we have some kind of two deep look of sorts. It could be quarters, it could be two deep, could be two man, but the middle of the field is open. There's no designated free safety in the middle of the field. So there's only a certain amount of coverages you can play out of this look, and a certain amount you can play out of that look. Many more out of this look than that look. But as a receiver in our running game, I always teach him, no matter what the defense is, every defense is designed for force. Every defense has a force player out of the secondary. No matter how they play it, somebody's responsible for forcing the run. If you're in a two deep look, who's the force? The force is the corner. If you're in the middle of the field closed look, okay, and the ball's coming to the split end side, this guy right here has got he's in the force pad right there. Generally speaking, I'm running the ball unless they have something else. Or they're playing with an outside linebacker here who's designed to turn it in, and then he comes inside and makes the force. Or if they're playing quarters, they're playing quarter-quarter, and this guy's playing quarter, and this guy's playing quarter, and they got a Sam linebacker playing wide. He's wide because he's turning it in, and that guy's, he's the force player out of the secondary. So there's always a force. So when I'm saying to the split end, on every play that runs your way split end, unless something's specifically designed, you have the force in the secondary, which I'll get to in a minute about the block and deal. But that's, so in teaching the running game, teach them, know if you got the force or no force. And I make them list it as they go through in their book, like the Z's out here, who have more, they have a tight end, they might have a lead, they have more things can happen to the Z side as far as whether he has the force or not force, because he might have a lead back and all that stuff, versus a split end, he's got the force all, just basically has the force all the time. So, over here to this side, this guy has more, and I make them list by the running game, force, no force. You know, so they know in terms of teaching the play, understanding what their response, how fast does the play get there? Is it a slow hitting play, fast hitting play? If you run a fast reverse, okay. If you run a reverse where the quarterback, you know, we'll do this sometime, we'll line up, and we did this last year, so we bring this guy in motion right here, and you know, we fake this and we give it to that guy coming around, and we read the end over and all that stuff. But that's a fast hitter, and I tell the X it's going to get there pretty quick. If it's going to be slower, I try to tell them slower. You know, I mean, I tell them that. So they have an awareness in their head that the clock is ticking. So I think those are things that are really important in just basic premises of football. Middle field, when you teach the passing game, you know, conversions are based off of middle field closed, middle field open type of stuff. You know, knowing what that is. In the running game, middle field open, middle field closed. You got to understand where the force is, because you got to know what that is. Question.
If you have a soft corner playing cover three.
Over here at the split end side?
Yep. And ball's going away. How do you teach your split ends to that. Stock that?
We're going to get to that. Okay. So I've kind of drifted away from the subject, but I think in the end I'm trying to give you a little food for thought about middle field closed, middle. And all the coverages that we get, I never refer, I'll tell them, they'll start to give me a whole lot of rhetoric, give me a lot of legislation. You ask them a question, what I want is tell me the middle field's closed, middle field open. I don't want to know how old your grandma is, did your sisters have their period, all that stuff right there. What I want to know is the middle field closed, the middle field open, and you tell me that, because that's what you need to see. And that's all part of the stance deal that we have. And then the next part, and kind of, I know we're not talking about stances right now, but you know what happens to our guys as well as your guys is they get up in line of scrimmage, they get in a good stance, and they look at the ball, and they don't know what's going on over there. So I always have what I call a peak rule. You take, if you're coming in line of scrimmage, you take two looks, what I call two looks, if you can. Sometimes if the ball snapped on first down, you can't. You hurry to get out to your position, get yourself into your proper alignment. You look as you get set, you look at the ball, and you peek back just in case, because as we all know, we've all seen this happen where maybe we have a good split inside running game, and they line up in a two deep look, you know, with a strong, with a weak safety over here, and all of a sudden they rotate this guy. This guy looks like he's off. He comes down. This guy comes over the top. He goes to the middle, and they're trying to take it away from him. And the receiver gets surprised because he doesn't know what's happening because he's looking inside. So that's a peek rule. Okay. I know you don't have as much time to teach your guys as I do in terms of all, but fundamentally speaking, that's a fundamental that I think you need to take from the first day. Just like the very first day they come in, what I do with our guys, the very first day of camp is stance for the first 5 minutes individual, stance and how to hold the football. And I don't give a damn if they've been playing for 10 years, we're going to do it, and we're going to do it, and we're going to do it, and I'm going to make sure they know so that we don't make mistakes. We have a good stance, we have a good foundation, and then we know how to hold the football. And I'll just go over that tomorrow. Everybody's got a different way of holding the football most of the time. I'm just going to show you what I talk to our guys all the time about. In the NFL, you have to really fight hard because they all want to stop. They all want to carry it with their big hand down here. What's wrong with that thing? Cool it in the end zone. And I always tell them, you damn sure better not ever fumble, because if you do, and a guy knocks out of your hand, you better keep going. So, find your $5,000 for dropping the damn ball. Anyhow, next part of the blocking deal. We talk about stalk, crack block. Okay? Now, you guys are allowed to crack, you just can't crack below the waist. Same rule we have. We can't crack inside the box, crack below the waist. You can't chop at all. We can chop down the field if the guy's in front of us, but they tighten up on the rules of pro football, so you can't come down in the box and chop and crack. Crack block. How you scheme it, you know, is really important. Rule for the crack blocker. I think this is the most important thing. I tell them this. When you have a design play to crack, say you're the split end, and we're going to crack the inside linebacker. Say they're in this, and they got a guy here, they got a guy here, and then they got a guy here. Okay. If you're going to crack the linebacker, you have to make sure you get that guy because we can't account for him. Generally speaking, in all your blocking, you know, when that guy's designed to be cracked, he has to be taken care of because the most important thing is you got to meet him at the junction, okay? And you have to go where they're going to be because anticipation is, you know, in practice, you can't get the look a lot of times that you want in the game. So I tell this guy, if this guy's lined up right here and he's 3 yards off the ball, your aiming point is going to be about a yard and a half in front of where he is. The worst thing that can happen is he sees it coming, he bubbles over the top, and that's okay. But we never let penetration happen because on any penetration play, any play where there's penetration and you have a crack, you've lost the battle. And I think the next thing is this. If I'm on the left here, and I'm going to crack Don, and I'm sitting here, my first step needs to be what I call a lead step. So I'm here. I want to turn my shoulders and cock them, which is what they'll want to do. You'll be sitting behind them. They'll be looking like that because they want to get there. Lead step inside. That means your center of gravity is good. You put a little bit more weight on that back foot, and your first step's got to be here. Because what they want to do is they want to do that, and then it's too late. So you must lead step. Huge, huge thing is getting the head in the right position. When you're cracking a guy, basically what you're trying to tell your kid is you're trying to seal him. We're trying to seal that defender so we can get outside of him. Your head must get across his sternum. Okay? So it's real important that you drive that head through that near shoulder into the sternum, you know, through the sternum area to get your head across. In football, so much of where your eyes take you determines whether you win or lose the battle. If I'm playing on Don right here and I'm a guard and the play's going that way and I can get my head across his bow right there, I'm going to win that battle more times than not. You know, when you look at pro ball, you see guys who have some pretty good, are stiff and aren't real athletic, And they lose a lot of wars because they can't get their head in the proper position. So your head placement is huge. Blocking, and especially on crack block. You watch the Super Bowl game, and one of the things that John Gruden did a great job of, they did what we call taxi. And I'll just go over this real quick. This is a, pro football has its fads that come and go. And one of the fads 2 years ago was people came out what we call a bunch set. Okay, and they'd come out in a bunch set and basically do this. They'd have an end lined up in this position right here. There'd be a linebacker in here, and there'd be a guy here, and there'd be a guy maybe a playing an over front or something like that, and they'd have a safety down like this, and a corner out here, and a safe, another safety in this. And we do what we call taxi, and on taxi, you know, it's a crack here, it's a crack there. This guy right here is going to lead outside. He's going to block down. The guard's going to pull around and take the next guy that shows inside. We call that truck. Three guys cracking down, pitching the ball in the back and going outside. In the Super Bowl, Gruden did a great job of running what we call taxis. And taxis meaning we go to a two receiver side. So he was doing stuff like this. He had Keyshawn Johnson lining up right there because he's a big physical, pretty good physical guy. He might take another guy and line him up right there. And then he'd have his back in whatever way he had him set. Okay, and he'd have another look over here like this. And then what he was doing a lot of times is they would have, a nickel guy lined up right here, and they had a corner over here and a safety. And then they had a guy here and a guy there, maybe a linebacker. What he was doing is he would bring this guy in motion, and they would crack, crack. He'd go, that guy do that, and pull that guard around right there at the center and cut that guy off, and then pitch it to him and run right up in the seam. You saw Pittman. That was what Pittman made a lot of yards on in the Super Bowl. Taxi, going to trying to get an advantage on the what we call the edges by crack blocking. And crack blocking is, you know, it gives you an edge if the element of surprise is really good and it ties in with your passing game. So you can get yourself a couple cheap plays if you just scheme it up. You know, you can get yourself some outs. Sometimes it's real hard. It's hard as hell to get outside on a sweep. You know, I mean, it takes time. The ball's pitched. You got to get your fullback out there. It's hard. But on taxis, and especially taxis and split inside, if you got a fairly physical wide receiver, you can crack, do some things along that line. Or, sometimes he'll even crack down on this guy. You know, they'll take this guy right here, block him down, and pull both these guys around right here and try to block, you know, and seal it off and get a crease. What you're looking for is a crease. In pro football, 4 yards is, you know, if you gain 4 yards of carry, you make a lot of money. So, I mean, you know, and if you get a 20-yard run, you're in great shape. So those are things that we try to, on crack blocking. So that's another technique for your receivers to do. And I think crack blocking, I love it because it's an element of surprise. And you know, the biggest thing is a good stance that you don't tip it. The biggest thing you got to do is you got a game plan, your splits, so that what you do every time you cut your splits down, you're not just cracking, that you got another, you can throw the ball out of the same looks. But I think it gives you a great advantage to be able to crack block people, especially if you get, sometimes you get miss, you know, you get size mismanagements and you're trying to get outside and you got a guy with some speed and, you know, you're trying to get to the corner fast, and you can do that if you got some kids that will stick their head in there. Yes, sir.
If you have a, let's say, a 160, 170-pound receiver that's cracking on a 220, 230-pound backer, it's obviously not going to be a knockout punch, right?
No.
You just want them having center of gravity, making sure that the head's in front. And
it almost
kind of turns into a stock block in a way.
In a sense. If you got a guy who's a real warrior, though, he wants to go in and knock the hell out of that guy. You know, what happens is, I always tell him this, if you got enough balls to go in the first time to really give it, lay the wood to him, the next time that guy's going to be looking you up.
Do you have them break down prior to laying the blow?
I don't want it. It just depends on the kid.
What if they whiff?
Well, generally they don't whiff. I mean, if you catch, first time, most of the time you won't whiff. Second time, he sees it coming. If you whiff, you make him whiff over the top. You never let the guy penetrate. Okay? If you got a kid that wants, I'm just saying to you what's happened. A lot of times you go in there and crack, I mean, a little guy will crack a big guy because he gets him by surprise. Now, the next time, I'm telling you, the big guys, even though if they know that guy come in, they'll look, I mean, he'll be looking and dancing, you know, and not trying to kill him. So, you have a question.
Yeah, how do you drill it at practice and crack without killing people?
get a bag, get a shield, get a shield, get a, you know, get a guy, maybe a pretty good sized guy that you got one to hold the shield. And, you know, you want a lead step, and you want to make it a fast tempo drill, okay, where you're getting in the stance, and you're, and you can just, I mean, you can get three or four reps when you guys are going to be playing. Don's lined up there, I'm here, okay, snap, step, crack, boom, hit it, okay, get two licks, turn around. Okay, I turn around, put the guy inside over here, now I'm on the other side, lead step. Going on there and get you a couple good whacks, and then you got to obviously put it into your practice plan, but you can. It's a good, it's a great element of surprise, and again, you try. I always try to tell a guy, you want to try to accelerate into the. If you accelerate into the hit on a guy and you bend your knees, most of my guys, okay, with the exception of, I had David Boston now, and you have him over here. David is an unbelievably big guy for a receiver. You may find it's hard to believe that he probably weighs 240, 241, and. Now, he can go in there and kill him, okay? But he wasn't my most fierce guy at 240. I had 195-pound kid. He'd go in there and whack him pretty good. And the reason he would whack him pretty good is I'd always tell him, accelerate into the crack. If you go in and slam on the brakes, and you're 250 and I'm 195, my momentum, you're going to win that battle. So, again, head placement, accelerating. Now, the next time, I tell him, next time you go in there, shield him off. You know, don't be afraid to use your hands, boom, knock them back, just hold them off and let the ball get outside. Then you try to work up the field. And the other rule, this is a rule. Whenever you have a crack, it always stays on. Hey, whenever you have a crack, and here's your rule. If the guy you're cracking disappears, go to the next guy that shows up the field. So if I got a crack block going and somehow this guy right here, you know, on the snap of the football, he disappears or does that right there, hey, look for the next guy coming to the inside. Because what? Don't run up in there and turn around and look. I want to know what I'm supposed to do. Keep it on. It always stays constant. Cracks never change. You got a crack, it stays on. There's no getting out of it. You just, if the guy disappears and you're cracking, stay on the neck. Just move to the next guy that shows from the inside. There'll be somebody coming. Okay, crack block. Cross field block. Okay, this is to answer your question about what do you tell the receiver on the backside. Our rule is this, the play's away from you, okay, you're in what we call a cross field blocking mode, all right, so, we're here, this is X over here, we're in a formation, we run a toss sweep, going this way, and we pitch it to this guy, okay, he has two rules, really, he has on this play right here. His rule is this, if the middle field's closed, let's say the corner's in this position, we got a weak safety, we got a strong safety, and we got a corner. Ball snapped, they pitch the ball here, this back's going to turn around the field, let's say, his rule is this, on the snap of the ball, you're going to lead step inside, and you're going for the inside shoulder of the weak safety. You're going to go for that inside shoulder. You're not going to go up the field and then go for him, you're going to lead step right down inside. And go hard for the inside shoulder, the shoulder away from you, of the weak safety. 95% of the time, what's going to happen? The weak safety is going to disappear. He's going to be gone there. This guy's going to be in his pursuit mode. You know, ball goes away. He's in a little shuffle. He sees it, and he starts going here. Okay, what I tell him is if the weak safety disappears, you make sure that your head is across the front of that guy right there. And you. If this guy runs 70 yards for a touchdown, when he goes in the end zone, you're here and that guy's there. Don't wait. Here's the mistake young guys make. They do this, they do everything you want them to do, and then this guy gets about here and they wait on the guy. And as soon as this guy crosses their face, that guy's no good to you anymore because the only thing he can do is block somebody in the back. So I tell him, you have to make sure you get your head across that guy's. You have to do that. You have to get your head across the front of that guy right there, no matter what the situation is. And if he goes into the end zone, you're still across right there, and you make sure you do. So cross field blocking is 90% effort and 10% technique. When I was at Detroit in 1997 and Barry rushed for 2,000 yards that year, we played Tampa Bay. We had, you know, this is we played Tampa Bay, and they were just getting good at that time. But he had 280-yard runs in about a five-minute span. And both the runs were basically, the success of the runs came for him going the other 40 yards by both of our backside receivers. We were in the slot formation. We were in a slot formation on one of them, and we ran a handoff. We ran the old stretch play to him into the sideline, and we had a slot like this, and they were in a, you know, they were in a rotational deal. They, I think they had a linebacker here, a safety in a corner. So what I tell them in slot is, I say to these guys right here, to take the same mode. You're going to go for release inside. Never pass up one to block another one. So if we're running the ball over here, okay, we're in a slot formation, we're running the ball over here, and you can cut that linebacker off, cut him off. If you make him go underneath, that's even better, because he takes himself out of the play, his pursuit angle becomes distorted. Same with this guy. You cross the field, and what happened in that game was the linebacker beat Herman Moore. He kept coming. This guy came on top, he got him, and then Johnny Morton came on the backside and blocked this guy, and Barry wound up going and cutting it back like that and scored a touchdown. So that's an effort play, and the key to it is lead step inside, don't go up the field. I always tell our guy, it's just a common sense thing. Why would you want to take 2-3 steps up the field, play's going away from you, and then when you start to pursue, the only guy you can hit is the guy who was over here, and the only way you can hit him is in the back. So get yourself in a position where you can get your head across the front of them. Okay, I think that's a very huge coaching point when you're talking about cross-field blocking. Okay. The last block that, in terms of what you teach receivers, is what I call push and seal. Now, this comes more to the split inside than it does to the flanker side. Although the flanker can get it some, and so can the slot. But you push and seal. Let's say we're here and we're running isolation. We're in a basic set, we're running an isolation play, and they got a corner in this position, they got a safety sitting in this position, and they got another safety here who comes down, or they got, you know, they got a corner here. Let's say we run a weak side isolation. So here we come, we run the ball, you know, he's there, this guy's leading up through, and we're running up in here like this. Now, push and seal, I tell our guys this. Be aware, you know, anytime we run the split inside, what have I told the split end? What's his rule? Who's he got? I told you that earlier.
The one block four.
He's always got the force. And see, from your standpoint, when you're coaching, you ought to ask the same question to that receiver. Who you got on split inside runs? I got the force. And that's what you want to know. So he knows that he has the force. So on push and seal will be this guy right here, maybe in, we'll come off the ball. Right here, we'll look at this guy, and if we know this corner's backing up, then he's in the force pattern, so we'll push it just a little bit, and then we come in and cut a pin inside and run it out. You know, but I always say this, in our game, you'd rather have the corners make the tackles any day than the safeties, because the safeties are the guys that get paid to make the tackles. So if we can seal this guy right here, and that back hits it, goes out here, we'll let that guy have to make the play. Plus, the other thing it does for your back, when you push and seal, is it enables your back to be able to get his pads going north and south as he hits the line of scrimmage versus going east and west where he can't get himself a turn to go that way. So push and seal we do on a lot of different situations. Now, if they rotate the coverage and we're there in this and this, he's got that guy. Push and seal only comes over if the corner does what I call bail technique. If he's up in a press position all of a sudden prior to the snap, he bails out of there, and say we got something on, we got a crack design, okay, and he sees it coming in, and then he goes. But if not, it depends on if he's got the force, and he's got to be aware of that. If we're in a slot field, now, we get this, you may not get this, we get this sometime, we'll be in a one-back set, we'll be in one back, and we get nickel looks and all kind of crap. And we may be like this, here's this guy. In the universal look in the NFL for, you always get, there's a nickel, there's a safety, there's a corner, and then you got linebackers, and so on. That's the look you're going to get on third down. That's the basic look. They try to give you a cover two shell on everything you do. what they'll do sometime, if you run the ball a little bit, and say we're running veer to the split inside right here, and we're running veer, they'll start to do this to you some. They may try to do this. This safety right here is starting to come down late, so this guy has to be aware of pushing seal too, because he's got to block that guy. We tell him anytime there's two possible guys, obviously he's not going, he can't get there, so you got to block the most dangerous guy, and block that guy, and he's got to beat that guy himself. But pushing seal can happen to a slot as well as it can happen to an outside, single outside receiver. Any question about, does this apply to you guys? Does it help you? I mean, it's hard for me as a receiver coach to spend, in practice, what I try to spend every day is, in our individual period, I try to get about, it depends on how much, how much new we have going in, but in our practice, I'll try to get, at least like a five, it might not seem like much, but for 5 minutes for us on a Wednesday practice is a fairly good amount of time to spend. So I'll always try to take one technique that we may be going to, if we're going to run in some taxi that week, we'll be working on the craft. But when we go to camp, I take that deal right there, we work on one of those every day. Stalk block, crack block, cross field block. They hate cross field block. And I tell them, if you don't cross field block and you don't hustle in practice doing it, what we do is, instead of running sprints after practice, what we're doing today, we're running cross fields. And I make them run cross field. I'll set up the bags, if you don't. I'll set up the bag. Like I said, you can. The thought of this, after they have to do it one time, you hit them cross field block. And you line them up like this. Okay, guys, we didn't hustle on cross field today, so here's what we're doing. They're there. Okay, and then I got a manager helping me, and so I'll line them up on the numbers. And I'll put those bags on the far set on the number, put a bag right here about 20 yards deep. When he runs across the field, got to get his head across, and he's got to throw on it when he gets over here. Then the guy sets it up, and this guy comes. And then this guy comes. And we turn around, and we go back the other way. We do that about 3 or 4 times on cross field blocking. And so when I say, what's your first thing you do on cross field blocking? It sounds like the chorus, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir chorus. Lead step. Where's your head go? You got to be pushing your body in a position to cross the last man on the backside in a cutoff position, and you got to, and then you got to hustle to get there. So, and then the last thing is that's a push and seal. We do some push and seal. And the hardest thing about push and seal is what you get, the look you get in practice. A lot of times it's not as fast as the look you get in the game. But push and seal is a pretty good way to, you can really help yourself, by doing that some if you guys are pretty good blockers.
When you push and seal, is it best that you can simulate it if you've got a linebacker, a corner, a weak safety?
Yes, it's a good little drill.
In high school level, you may not have that many kids available.
I mean, what you can do on push and seal is it's a great, here's what you do. You put this split in out here, and you take three guys. You really don't need three guys. You need this corner and a safety. And you stand on this side, and you say to the corner. So he backs up, and you tell that guy, when you tell the corner to back up, you tell this guy to take a step back and then come down. Okay, so he, the corner's lined up there. He takes a step up the field vertically, or even two steps. He sees that corner backing up. He looks at the safety. And then the other thing is, when you go to seal that guy, you go back to your crack rule, going where he's going to be. So he's coming in and sealing, and you start to run right where he is, and he accelerates, and then you're on the back end. You can't block anybody. Then you stand over here on this side right here. Again, here's the coach. Okay, here you are. Now you have the corner. Now you have the corner lined up off, like this. You have them at maybe even level, and you tell the corner to come on down. Here he comes, and he squares up. There's the force. You got to block the force. That way, it prevents them from guessing. And you're working, you're incorporating the drill. Not only that, you're working two drills. You're working the stalk block, you're working the crack block, and you're working push and seal all at one time. Because what you're doing is, and you don't need a lot of guys. You got a blocker, you got a corner, you got a corner, you got a safety. And you're over here on this side, and you're telling the corner, I'm gonna give you one or two things. You tell the corner, get the drill coached up before you get out there. Here's what we're gonna do today with the perimeter and our blocking drill. For the wide receivers. Okay. If I put you on defense, okay, Joe, you're going to be one of the corners, and you're going to be, Sam, you're going to be one of the safeties. Here's what we're going to do. If I tell you to go that way, I want the safety to back up, come down. If I tell you to come on down, if I tell you to get up here tight, and sometimes you just put the guy up tight, and you say, okay, well, you got the force, and you don't, and the guy, and he's waiting for something to happen, and he comes off flat foot, and the guy knocks his ass off. You know, you help to teach him that way, too. And again, you go back to the same old thing about the fundamental, the stance, center of gravity, making sure you got a nice center of gravity. And when you explain to him the center of gravity, I do this like with David Boston. He was a great basketball player in high school. I say to him, David, get a wide base and shoot your jump shot. And, you know, it'll register for them. They understand that you have to have balance to be a good football player. And you need to use your insteps, not only when you cut as a receiver, but when you block. It's like, tell a guy to do a squat. Go in, get some weight on the squat rack, okay? And don't use the balls of your feet. Be flat-footed. It's a hell of a lot harder. It's a hell of a lot. You can take a lot more weight down when you're using the balls of your feet to come down than it is when you're just flat-footed. So, I mean, those are things that are really important things, elements in terms of making them understand the mechanics of their body and how it works. I talked to you about the blocking rules about, let me see what else I got down here. I talked about the simple rule that, you know, what we do as receivers, what we do as receivers, you know, we say when another receiver catches the ball, you know, if you guys weren't in here, we tell them, everybody else turns and blocks the guy covering them. You know, we don't run around like a chicken with a head cut off. Look, when another receiver catches the ball, you turn and block the man covering you. It's a simple rule. It takes care of everything you need to know. We're not running all over the field, you know, trying to figure out who to block. So I'll tell our guys, I'll make them, again, Don, what do you do when another receiver catches the ball? The only answer I want is to turn and block the man covering you. Chances are when that happens in the game, in practice, and you got to emphasize in practice, I bitch at them. If you ain't blocking the man covering you, I'm going to bitch at them. I'm going to be bitching at them because I want that to be instinctive. You have to do these things to make them do it. You can verbalize them. You can show tape. I have some of the greatest tapes that you'll ever see in my tape collection. I've been coaching receivers my whole life. I've had Pro Bowl guys. I've had guys that weren't worth shooting and all of a sudden got to be pretty good. And I have a wonderful tape library. And you'll see some of it in the second part of this thing in another hour or so. But what I tell them is, if it was just as easy as watching tape, then all you had to do is go watch tape and be a good player. You know, just because you see it doesn't mean you can do it. So the way you're able to see it and do it is to drill it. And you have to drill it. And you have to drill it. You know, you don't have time to do them all. But you can take that one little drill and incorporate three things in one time, which is a time saver for you. And you don't have to do it every day. And again, the kids that you want that are going to be playing for you, you know, I think you have to do that. And that's the hardest thing when you have a kid with great, it's a good little kid, he's got great effort, and you know, you want him to get his rep, and you don't want to discourage him, and you're out there and you're trying to, you know, so I have to do the same thing in training camp. When we go to training camp with 10 wide receivers. 10. You say, wow, that's a lot of guys. Well, we have 8. We're allowed 80 guys at camp. That's what we're allowed. We're allowed 80 players when we go to camp. And every player's got to have a contract, and he has to have it signed. So when we go to camp, 10 of them are wide receivers. Probably 12 of them are defensive backs because who's doing all the running? We are. So you need guys. You need legs for guys. You don't want to kill your guys that are going to be your studs, you know, during the season. But the thing is I got to make sure my players that are going to do playing. I haven't got time for 10 guys to get 2 reps on that little drill right there. So we make sure my guys, and I tell the other guys, if they're trying to make a team, you got to see it. And when you get a chance to do it, you might not be able to get it today, maybe a couple of days from now. But when I call your name, you got to be able to get up there and get it done. It's harder for you than it is for me because, you know, the guy that doesn't get his rep, he's trying to make the team and make some money. And your guy's just trying to win his letter jacket. See what I'm saying? But it's the same premise. Kids, you don't want to hurt their feelings. You know, I don't want a guy coming out of college who's coming to camp as a free agent to feel like he is a free agent. But you got to get the guys ready to play that you're going to play. You know, when you start your season, then you gotta get them trained. So I think those are some elements right there that are important. Okay, they talk about, I got a second error right there, which I'll be. Another thing, when you're in, how many of you do 7-on-7? Everybody does 7-on-7. Great time to emphasize turn block command cover and you think. And if a guy doesn't, if a guy's not doing it, you know, if a guy, one guy doesn't do it, then I think you make, you know, you make a note of it. And you, you know, and I make, I'll just call him out right there. What's your rule? If you can't, you know, and then, you know, you gotta make, he's got it. And then everybody gets on his butt and he becomes, and he knows what he's gotta do and you help yourself.
You can do the same thing with middle of the field open, middle of the field closed, during 7-on-7 in terms of marking out a rule and reading that.
Reading coverage, oh yeah.
Yeah. Because do you really emphasize reading the actual coverage, knowing what coverage are in, or is it just as simple as what you're saying there, open or closed?
The only time it could, you know, it gets a little, most people in our league give you a cover two look to do what they're going to do to Saskatchewan. Now, don't get me wrong, there's a lot of tricks. And the more, in our league where you get in trouble in terms of recognizing coverage sometimes, and when they try to screw you, is in, when third down, when they, you know, you send in your third wide receiver or your fourth wide receiver, and then they go to what we call nickel dime, where they got six DBs in the game, and they got a five, like you play Philadelphia, and they got 20 different blitzes they'll give you out of their secondary, and they're damn good at it. So you gotta be careful, but again.
But on our level, on the high school level, if you could get a kid to recognize closed or open,
even him, you got some routes probably to convert versus different looks. You know, you may not have a lot of them, but you have, you know, like we have a route that we run, you know, everybody runs a guy down the middle against cover two in some shape or form, and we may be in, you know, this kind of look right here, we may call, 999 balloon. 999 balloon for us is everybody's running nines and we're distributing the field. He's going on a nine. This guy's going on a nine. This guy's going on a nine. And this guy right here, he reads the middle of the field. Okay, in the middle of the field, let's say they're in a two deep. You got a nickel guy sitting here. Most of the time, the nickel plays there. They're there. Okay, got linebacker here. Then, okay, so they're in a two deep look. And this guy right here is the bender. He's the bender. He decides the middle field's open. He's got to hit the middle. So I'll tell him, you know, read it, get up here and give him a little wrinkle. And you take it thin down the middle. Let the quarterback lead you to the middle. Don't get yourself on the backside where you get smashed. If it's a too deep look, most of the time it's pretty easy to recognize. Now, sometimes we give it a soft one. They play a soft too deep look where you're not sure. But the most difficult thing is when they play what we call, some people will play the quarters, they'll give you a two deep look and he'll bail out of there. These safeties will move outside, and he'll move outside, and then they play quarter. What do I tell this guy? I tell him, if you think the middle of the field's open, take it. If the quarterback doesn't like the look, he don't have to throw it. But that way you keep from getting too much revenue and getting confused. But we have guys, believe me, I have guys that flunk the ACT test when I get them, and then you have to coach them just like you coach younger kids. So, I mean, those are things that are, I think, very applicable. You know, we try to keep it, we have a lot of route adjustments, and they have to see the coverages, but middle field closed, middle field open is just a simple way to put it for them, and it makes it, and once they figure it out, they feel like they really accomplished something, because we get a lot of trash. But if you could just say, is it closed? Because if it, you know, if it's closed, you know, you limit to some of the coverages. If it's open, you can get too deep, you can get too man, and maybe some kind of screwy rotation of some kind, but other than that, we don't worry about it. Anything else on that, along those lines? Anybody got a question that about something blocking-wise that I haven't brought up that you got in your mind that you might, yes, sir?
Well, when they're playing press, you usually want to run them off, but there comes a point where that corner recognizes that the ball's not going to be thrown.
You know when you usually recognize them? When your receiver turns his head to look back and wonder what's happening, which I bitch at him. That's not, you know, your job. Here's what I tell a guy. When you're running a guy off as a runoff, your job is it's a 60-yard sprint. Don't look back unless the guy covering you has a heart attack. And you can look back. saying when you run a clear out route. Because what happens is they want to get up the field 8 to 10 yards, they want to look around and see what's happening. And say, hey, you, that's not your job, is this on this play, your job is to run a 60-yard sprint, don't look back. Same thing when you're an outside receiver. You got that guy, he's your guy to block, don't look back. If you don't look back, you won't look back. As soon as you, the head is such a, for a receiver, the head is such a huge thing in what you do. Like when we run routes, I tell them, your feet get you out before your head comes around. When people start, like when you're teaching guys to run, I'm kind of getting on a tangent a little bit off of what I was talking about, but when you what are the hardest routes to teach? The hardest routes to teach are routes where you're running vertical and you're stopping quickly. What do guys want to do? They want to start turning their shoulder to get their head around, and what happens is it distorts your ability to come out with your feet, of which I'll show you later on. Okay, but in my different presentations, I have that on tape and I'll show you. But the head, and so don't look around. You know, and it's, you gotta let them know this is a rule. When you're a clear out guy, you got a 60-yard sprint, don't look back. Same when you're a blocker. If we're running a screen your way and your guy, you know, you'll see him on screen sometimes, 15 yards, they look back and wonder what's going on. The corner sees him look back, and, you know, he gets a feel that nothing's going on because there's speed changes. You know, I tell him from the first day, when you're running a 5-yard hitch or you're running a 60-yard takeoff, your posture, your body posture to a receiver is how you appear to the defensive back. Those are words that I use on our guys. What's posture mean? Posture means how you look. How do I want you to look? I want you to look like a smooth, fluid, graceful ballerina. Not like a bull in a china shop or a herky-jerky kind of guy. So what you're planning in your mind is the smooth, fluidness that you want. How many, the smoothest guy in all my years of coaching the NFL that I ever coached was Tony Martin. I don't know how many of you remember him when he played for the Chargers, but Tony was about 6 foot, weighed about 185 pounds, could really run. And usually guys that can run real fast generally don't look like they're running that fast. I have a young kid named Brian Gilmore that went to a little tiny school in Texas called Midwestern State, which is in Wichita Falls. He was a track kid from a little town in Texas. Didn't get a whole lot of coaching in college. Was on our developmental squad, and all of a sudden the light kind of came on last year. And he was just about ready to go to my number two receiver, from number four to number two, and he got hurt. But he's like Tony. He's so smooth, they don't look like they're running fast. I always say, when Tony Martin was playing, you could put a glass of water on his head, he could run 100 yards, and it'd be full when he got to the finish line, because that's how smooth and fluid. And that's what you want to embrace to a receiver. There's, you know, two, you know, on one sense, stalk, crack, you want tough guys. And they aren't all going to be tough. You know, you're going to have some guys, if you got a tough guy and that's what he can do best, use him. Get him in a formation where you can run that taxi to the split inside. Let him be the crack guy. You know, build his confidence. Sometimes you'll see guys become better football players because you give them a play, they get real good at it. Their teammates, you know how it is in high school, all of a sudden this guy, he's a nobody, and all of a sudden one day you put him in, you know he's got a little thumbs, you put him in and you crack, he cracks somebody, feels like he just conquered the world, and all of a sudden he's one of the boys, and all of a sudden you start to see his confidence improve on special teams, he becomes more of one of the guys, he feels at home, and all of a sudden you got yourself another football player. And I think that happens in our game too, a lot of times. Brian Gilmore, the kid I was telling you about, that was him. He started, you could just see his confidence. He used to be a guy, when he'd make a mistake, he'd kind of, old head, he'd kind of sink down in his shirt, you know. All of a sudden, he started making plays and getting confidence. And, hey, put him in a game here, hit him on a little 5-yard pass, man. Made the corner miss, and he was faster than David for 40 yards. And I'm saying probably 4.31, something like that. And he gets fly. And just smooth, but, you know, and he was a tough guy, I was telling you about, 195 pounds. And he began to do things, and you brag on. We were playing the Giants. We ran and run. David was out of wind, and I put him in there. We ran a split inside play. He pushed and sealed, block of safety. We hit that thing for about 30 yards down the sideline. He cracked that guy. I mean, the guys on the sideline jumping up and down. Guys happy. You know, that's why you coach the game. You know, as long as I've been coaching, teaching. I've been pro foot. I coached in college for 17 years. And I've been pro ball. This will be next year. I'm in my 13th year. The elements of teaching are why I stay in the business. It isn't about the craft. It's about taking a guy and getting him to be as good a player as he can be, and watching him grow and teach him. That's what I like to do. So being a coordinator for me was, I told him, I said, well, you want me to be a coordinator, but I'm a coach, because I'm not going to be what they call a walk-around guy. I don't want to be walking around like a stooge. I want to be coaching and teaching, because that's what I like to do. So, you know, I salute you guys, because you're the heart and soul of what football is all about. I think, you know, being able to teach young kids and see their confidence grow, and, you know, taking as much as you can take and putting it in the kid's head and watching them develop and be the best player and get confidence and become, you know, all those things are huge, and I think I admire you guys for it. You get, you know, you get that satisfaction. We do too, but it's a little different. And probably got it more to college than I did pro football, but I love that part of the game. It's the most, it's why I do what I do. So, really on the blocking ends of what we're going to talk about, you know, I think, again, incorporating these things in practice are important. One of the things that we do during 2-a-days, I don't know how many times, you guys ever get a chance to do a perimeter run drill? You know, what you do is, you, instead of doing 7-on-7, you take the linebackers out of it naturally because they get in the way, but you can do a 7-on-7. In other words, you got a quarterback, you got two wide receivers, a tight end, two wide receivers. You may put line up an outside linebacker of sorts, and you got your backs, and what you're doing is you're running, you know, you work a perimeter run drill. You throw a toss, sweep, weak. Your receiver, you know, your fullback goes up in there and pretends he's blocking the linebacker or whatever it is, and so your receivers are working on them. Their defensive backs, in the meantime, are working on their position. They're getting themselves in position in terms of how they're going to play. You know, who's got the force, push him outside, you know, I'm going to meet him with my, you know, inside shoulder, keep my outside arm free, turn it in, you know, and all that, and then your receivers are blocking, and so you take a 10-minute period at some point in time, you do a perimeter run drill on your favorite runs that are outside. You know, those are things that you can get done, and you can, again, incorporate your backs and your, and the defensive back coach likes it because he gets to work on his perimeter stuff, and it's not a bad way to go. Okay, it's a pretty good way to do things. In the next hour, okay, in the next hour, just so you'll know, I have, here's what I'm going to be doing in the next hour. We're going to talk about catching the ball, talk about hand placement, talk about different kind of routes and hand placement, talk about some drill, sideline drill, gauntlet crossing drill, deep ball drill, scoop drill, high ball drill, run after the catch, those types of things. And I'm going to have some video. I'm going to show you some video of that. And there'll be some other things that we're going to do tomorrow, like talk about releases versus press, and I'm going to do some of that on the field. I'm going to do some of the release stuff on the field, because I think, you know, you can, that's something you have to really spend a lot of time. I probably spend in camp, I probably spend 10 to 15 minutes a day on releases versus press. You know, some of them are actually in the period, some of them are just, these wide receivers have worked together on it. And there's a million, the center of gravity becomes the hugest thing that you can ever talk about in press releases. How many of you get press? Yeah, it's, a few years ago I did a clinic, nobody got press. Last time I was here, I think I asked some guys, and I said, how many guys got press? And maybe two hands went up out of 40. You know, now everybody's press is the mode. You know, we get it very physical, you know, and we get big, but still, it's the same, technique-wise, it's the same thing. So those are some things that will be incorporated. But in the next period, talking about catching the ball, I think there's a lot of things you can do to incorporate, you know, catching the football, making it easy for you guys, you know, to get some things done like you want to do in terms of catching the ball. Again, time becomes a big element, you know, even for us, you know. During the season, our players, we play Sunday, just to give you an idea of our time too, because people think, well, you guys got them all day. Sunday, they play. Monday, they come in and they generally they come in about noon. They come in about 11. They have to lift. They get a little run in, and we watch the tape from the game. And we may talk to them individually or something. And they leave Tuesday. They're off. They come back in Wednesday. We have we'll have a 15-minute individual period, and we'll get into some. Basically, after that, besides a one-on-one period where we go one-on-one with the DBs, we'll do 7-on-7 and team, and maybe some other, maybe an emphasis on the blitz, who we're going to play this week, where the blitz is going to be coming from, how we're going to sight adjust, and how we're going to pick it up, and all that stuff. But we don't get a lot of individuals, so you have to, when you come out of camp, you have to have your basic fundamental foundation set. Because then Thursday they come in, we do nickel. And then Wednesday's first down, second medium. When they come in Wednesday, it's all Thursday, it's all third down stuff. And one back stuff, third down stuff, some short yardage, some goal. And Friday, when we come in Friday, we go through goal line, and we go through our red zone. And then Saturday, and, you know, we just have a show them the practice, and then Sunday we play. So we don't have a lot of individual time, too, so you have to set your foundation for what you're going to do in terms of, you know, just like I told you, you got to get those things done early on, because you don't have as, you can't, you're working scheme more during the season than you are, you know. But I try to get, like, I'll take one route and emphasize it. You know, you got 15 routes, say, that you know, they're in your rotation of what you do. You can't get them all 15, but if you start at point A and you hit the ones that you don't haven't hit in a while, be able to keep them fresh, you know, somewhat in their mind. Some weeks, depending on what we're going to see, we'll run some more than others, where they get a chance to do them. But, you know, basic premises of routes and route tree and all that kind of stuff, we don't have, again, it's not a lot of time, so you got to pick out the things you want to do and then and get them, you know, try to do them. In the blocking end of it, I'd be less than honest with you if I told you that the fundamental blocking end of it, we do a great job at camp, and usually as the season goes on, we get less time to do it. Because as the season goes long, we have 16 regular season games. You try to cut your practice down from about game 10 on, where you're not on the field as much as they begin to get tired. You get guys injured and you don't have them. But you still got to be talking about them. You got to be showing them. And you got to run the ball every week, so you got to be able to see what you're doing, pushing, seal cracking, all that stuff. And so in the next hour, like I said, I'm going to talk about some things, but I want to show you some video of, you know, we're talking about catching the football. That's the emphasis of the thesis of the next hour is catching the football. And, you know, there's so many little elements to catching the football, and make, you know, hand placement and head and eyes and shoulders and those kind of things. And deep balls and why guys drop them and elbow placement on deep balls and things like that. So that's what we'll do in the next hour. That's it. Anybody got anything else? Thank you for, I hope you got something out of it. I enjoyed the few questions, and thanks a million.
Did your heart drop to your shorts when you bought and got traded?
It wasn't a trade.
Heart, not even.